live from Santa Monica, it's the Tomorrow Show with Hooray!
Thank you. Thank you. Please sit down. Oh, sit down. You're too kind. You're too kind. Flowers. I can't believe you guys got me flowers as well. Oh. Oh. There you go, my dear. Ladies and gentlemen, it is an absolute pleasure of mine to welcome you to the very first episode of the very first season of The Tomorrow Show. As this is the very first episode, I thought it fitting to introduce myself. My name is Gray Bright. I, of course, share the same name as a paint swatch at Home Depot. Comedy lights as well. Comedy lights there. My background is I studied robotics and have been working alongside technology products all my life, from building them as a kid to working in buying and marketing and manufacturing and development. I've performed comedy across the globe, mainly my kitchen, but tonight I think we're going to have a bit of fun. So that sort of gives an understanding as to why I thought this show would exist. I thought it would be very, very fun to build a live late-night talk show focused on science and tech. So over the course of the season, I'm going to have up on stage with me people who inspire me, people I look up to, and an amazing assortment of people all the way from the science, technology, engineering, arts and mathematics world. And so we're going to have a lot of fun. We're going to poke a lot of fun at science and tech, mainly because I firmly believe that in 2015, scientists, engineers and entrepreneurs are the new rock stars. Well, I suppose we better kick off with some jokes. And it's the perfect time to do so. There's so much going on in the world of science and technology these days. Every day it seems like a new product's being released. Just last Thursday, Apple began shipping the Apple Watch to pre-order customers, even though stock remains sold out, though not as sold out as George Lucas. Burnt my finger on that joke. I burnt my finger. This is Los Angeles, so some people here may actually know him. If you know George, let's not say anything, yeah? Don't tell him. He could probably destroy this production. Or as he refers to it, digitally remaster. Right? Now I've started. Hit record. Put your clothes back on. Let's do this. Google just last week released a Loch Ness version of street maps. How they did this was they put cameras on boats and they went and mapped the entire Loch Ness, the famous lake in Scotland, where the mysterious Loch Ness monster is believed to live. The next location of an imaginary beast that they say they'll map is the Kardashians' dignity. Everybody's cheeky, lovable larrikins, the North Koreans are back in the news. South Korea have come out saying that they have hard evidence of hacking code used by North Korea during a 2013 cyber attack. Turns out North Korea's equipment is so old, it's also the cheat code to the 1987 classic Nintendo game Contra. Enter password. Up, up, down, down, left, right, BA, start. Oh, I'm in. The Konami code for anyone out there. Favourite cheat code of all. You all may have seen this. Our friends over at the I Effing Love Science blog this week posted a link and a corresponding image to an article titled, "Can Spiders Grow to the Size of a Puppy?" I have no idea of the answer. I was too busy yelling, screaming and setting fire to my computer. Big news in meteorites, big meteorite news here. NASA have said that during 2016, Californian residents are going to be witness to an amazing meteorite shower. And if the Californian government doesn't stop wasting water, that's the only shower we'll be receiving. Ladies and gentlemen, we have a massive show here for you tonight. I have two of the most incredible guests going around. The first one, she is an astrobiologist. She is also flight director of Zero G Corporation. She is a Virgin Galactic astronaut and co-founder of Yuri's Nights, which is the astronaut dance party. Her name is Loretta Whitesides. My second guest is one of the most awarded artists and designers going around. You can see his work in museums across the world. He has his office in the same studio as Will.i.am. He is an absolute guru at 3D printing, so much so that he is the creative director of the world's largest 3D printing company, Yanni Catan. We're going to close the show out with the musical stylings of the ever-talented Tudor Waters, goes by the surname of Williams, and his band. Ladies and gentlemen, Stick Riggers. We'll be right back after this. Welcome back. Now, I really like to stay up to date with the latest and greatest in new technologies, products and services. One of my favourite places to find new products is in the world of crowdfunding. But with so many amazing new products each day from sites like Kickstarter and Indiegogo, it's hard to keep track. So I thought I'd make a list of my favourite crowdfunding projects from this week and share them with you all in a little segment we like to call Crowd Watching. First up, and these are all real, first up is a revolutionary product for all of those times that you want to have a cell phone strapped to your head. The tagline of this product is the cell phone headband flashlight will be very useful to everyone who carries a cell phone. So that's a large demographic. Now, I also think they're selling themselves a little bit short. The product is currently only being marketed as a cell phone headband flashlight, but it's so much more than that. I think wearing one of these is the perfect way to tell a loved one that you're on medication. Now let's have a look at some of the features. It says that the cell phone headband flashlight is good for daytime or nighttime jogging. Ah yes, a daytime flashlight, or as it's known by its other name, the sun. Another wonderful selling point is keep it in your car in case of emergencies such as flat tires. A common misconception. I think they'll find that what works better than a flashlight is a spare tire. Now, what I like most about this is their business plan. Our goal is to have everyone on this planet own two or more cell phone headband flashlights. Right, we're going to do the math on this. So get your calculators out. There are 7.1 billion people on Earth. They want everyone to have two or more. 14.2 billion of these are about to be manufactured. Now, this also means selling at $24.99, so if I carry the one and I take the six and I divide it around, that means their first year revenue is going to be $355 billion. If there's any VCs watching, I think this is what you refer to when you say a unicorn company. Well, I certainly hope to own two or more of these in the near future. Up next is a little project for the animal lovers out there. This project is called Dolphinese. Talk to the dolphins in their own native language. It's not really a small project. They're asking for $1.71 million. Now, with a month to go, they're on $75. So let's see whether we can help them. If anyone has a spare 1.17. Now, even though they're trying to raise $1 million, I don't think you need to spend $1 million on a device to hear a dolphin say, "Get me out of SeaWorld." Next up is a lovely little science project. This one is called CH4. Now, if you haven't picked up what this is, CH4 is the chemical equation for methane. That's right, it's 2015. This product sits in your back pockets and sniffs your farts. Let me be the first to welcome you all to the future. You've made it. Welcome. Welcome, you're here. Smells good. Smells good. Now, I'm going to run you through, and you can go and have a look at this on their page. I'm going to run you through their manual. And I've made a slight tweak. Their manual goes, step one, turn on the CH4. Step two, place it in your back pocket. Step three, now it's not going to be what you think it is. Step three, fart. It's exactly what you thought it was, isn't it? It's exactly what you thought it was. The CH4 also comes with an app that allows you to keep track of the foods you eat. But the feature that sold me on this campaign is this sketch of how it's used. Nothing says buy me more than a rudimentary sketch of a naked person with a device that's sniffing their farts. Ladies and gentlemen, that was crowd watching. We'll be right back after this. Welcome back. I can't tell you how excited I am to have my next guest up on stage with me. She's an absolute superstar, someone who I'm sure after you hear her, you're going to be looking up to her as well. She's an astrobiologist who's worked on projects ranging from the International Space Station all the way through to terraforming Mars. She's the flight director at Zero G Corp and co-founder of the awesome International Astronaut Dance Party, Yuri's Nights. Ladies and gentlemen, please give a big round of applause, Loretta Whitesides. So good to see you. Thank you. Thank you. Please have a seat. Loretta. Oh, well, firstly, what is an astrobiologist?
Somebody who studies life on Earth and off Earth.
So life on Earth and off Earth. Does that mean, like, are we talking just in our solar system or are we talking the entire universe?
Whole universe. So yeah, we study life on Earth and how life evolved on Earth. We also look at how terrestrial organisms could live off planet, and we also look for evidence of life on other planets.
Have you found anything?
Nothing yet.
No secrets?
We're working on it.
You'd tell us, wouldn't you?
I would.
Okay, all right. So run me through. Let's give everyone a little bit of a background. Where were you as a kid? You're so heavily in the science and space world. Was this always what you wanted to do? Like, what was your childhood?
Oh, absolutely. Like, I remember being 6 years old and playing spaceship under the stairs at my cousin's house. We had, like, the silver ducting, you know, under the stairs.
Yeah.
We had our mummy sleeping bags. We thought we were the coolest kids ever. Yeah. No, I've known since as far back as I can remember, space has been my thing.
Okay, so through school, did you then go study?
Yep. Went to Stanford. Studied biology. I figured it was next to a NASA center, so that would be pretty good. Set up being next to NASA Ames. It all worked out pretty well.
Okay, now, once you finished studying, you ended up at NASA, didn't you?
Yeah.
How does one end up at NASA? What is the actual process to get inside NASA?
Well, mine was a little unorthodox. Most kids do the co-op route, which is more traditional, but we didn't have a co-op program, and so when I graduated, I just cold called NASA Johnson, and
operator NASA, please.
Yeah, something like that. And this is pretty, this is the dawn of the internet, so it's not like you can just look up the number online in those days. So I'm that old.
So you went and worked at NASA. You were working on projects like the International Space Station. What were some of the other things that you did there?
Oh, it was fantastic. So I started out working in the astronaut office because, if you're going to go to Houston.
That is the coolest name for an office, by the way. I think you'll agree.
What's better is the Monday morning staff meetings.
What happens?
It's all astronauts. You're like,
what?
How come I get to be here? Yeah, no, it was amazing. And I got to be in the astronaut office when Shannon Lucid came back from her six-month stint on the Mir. Russian space station.
Were you
in her debrief? It was just amazing. She's an amazing woman.
So what happens in a debrief like that? So she's been up there. What are the questions that they ask someone?
Well, she did really well. She got along really well with her crewmates, and she had a fabulous time. She just, you know, did great research, and she was always cheery and happy-go-lucky, and everyone sort of said, how did you do that? You're eating, you know, pickled herring out of a can, because it was Russian, you know, it was a Russian space station.
That, so are you saying that they even still make Russian astronauts line up for bread on the space station?
It's not the kind of food that I'm used to eating, but Shannon's, you know, she's a trooper. She just rolled with it, and she always had a smile on her face, and so everyone at the debrief was definitely interested to know what her secret was, and her secret was her attitude.
That is incredible. Okay, so we've now got you at NASA. You've been working on the space station, doing crazy meetings. What did you do from there?
I went back to California. I went to NASA Ames and worked at first at the NASA Academy for the summer, and then for Dr. Chris McKay, working on terraforming Mars.
Right. Terraforming Mars. What is it?
Making Mars' atmosphere or more Earth-like. So ameliorating, increasing the pressure and increasing the temperature so that it's more suitable for humans or plants.
And we're talking the entire planet. We're not doing like Pauly Short biodome little blobs anywhere. I don't know whether I want to live in a world or a planet where that happens. Is it the entire landscape?
You could start with a dome, but the goal of terraforming is to thicken the atmosphere such that the whole planet becomes livable.
So we're basically, is the theory we could put a factory on Mars, pump out whatever chemicals into the atmosphere to thicken it up, warm up the planet.
Yeah, we have a lot of experience with planet warming. It's dual use technology. It's fantastic.
So, vicariously by destroying our planet, we've worked out how to live on another.
It's genius. It's really, you gotta always.
Everything's all good. We don't need to worry. So, is this still theoretical, or is this something that we really could do to Mars?
I mean, it's both. It's definitely very theoretical at this point, but it's definitely something we could do. I mean, it's not too far fetched in the next 100 years to increase the temperature on Mars such that you could have liquid water be stable on the surface.
So if we warmed up Mars, then we almost get minerals and some other livable items. Is that right? That sounds like a good plan. Seems feasible to me. So we go from terraforming Mars. Where did your career take you from there?
Well, that's when I decided I wanted to go back to graduate school. I wanted to be like Dr. McKay. So I went to get my PhD. I went to Caltech and become a PhD astrobiologist.
That is so cool. That is absolutely amazing. So you go back there. I imagine a PhD is quite difficult to do.
I didn't finish the PhD.
No.
Skip that part.
No, we can cut that out and edit. No. No, but finishing a PhD would mean that you actually ended up going down the academic route, which is absolutely not what you wanted to do, is it?
Yeah.
So you wanted to go down and really explore. Tell me, like, what is your goal at the moment?
My goal is to... Well, basically, when I was in academia, I realized that the state of the art of the research was just not where I wanted to be. I wanted to, you know, build these life support, you know, bioregenerative life support systems on other off planet. And we just weren't at the point where we could do that yet. And there wasn't anyone funding that, moreover. And so I realized it was time to get out and push. And that's why I'm so excited to be here, because I think getting people excited about science and on board with all this became my new mission.
Is that not a mission? That is so cool. That really is awesome. Now, I mentioned at the beginning the astronaut. It was actually someone in the crowd is described it like this to me. It's an astronaut dance party. There's an event called Yuri's Nights. Can you explain to us what it is?
So it's an annual worldwide grassroots distributed do-it-yourself space party. So we started yurisnight.net, and we just encourage, it's like, we call it the St. Patrick's Day for space, and we just encourage people, you know, just to throw their own parties, you know, and everywhere around the world, just to get people excited about space and to share their passion and love for space and science with their city.
So when did this start? How did this come about?
Started in 2001. I realized that it was the 40th anniversary of Yuri Gagarin, the first human to go into space. His flight was coming up on April 12th, 2001, and that would also be the 20th anniversary of the first shuttle flight. And it was like a Russian space holiday and a U.S. space anniversary, you know, two great tastes in one candy bar. It was like the perfect, you know, I was so passionate as a little girl, you know, growing up in the Cold War, I was always really interested in, you know, why can't we just get along?
Yeah.
And so I thought if we could bring the Russian, you know, the idea of bringing the Russian space program and the American space program together was something that was always dear to me ever since watching, you know, 2010. And, you know, and luckily that's where we headed, you know, with the space station. And so I thought we should celebrate that and encourage them to keep cooperating.
So very cool.
Let's keep that going.
That's so awesome.
We did a party.
So then after, so that was, what year did you say that
2001.
Was? 2001. So then flight director of Zero-G, how did that come about?
That was 2004. So I met Peter Diamandis, who is a force of nature, an extraordinary innovator and magic maker. And he started XPRIZE and Zero Gravity Corporation. And so he was here in LA and became a mentor of mine when I was at Caltech. And he said, you know, I'm starting this Zero-G company. We're going to fly around people who want to go into space. And, you know, I want people really enthusiastic and passionate and excited about space to work on the airplane. And I said, yeah, pick me. So.
I haven't been on this plane. How does it work? Does it really... The plane goes like that, and you end up like floating around.
You're in. It's a cargo airplane, so there's no windows, and it feels like a magic room for the most part. You know, as you're going the bottom of the pullout, everything gets really heavy. You're like, and then as you get up over the top, it's kind of like you're on a country road and you go over a big bump, except it's a really big bump.
This is the biggest bump ever.
And it just feels go from feeling really heavy to just suddenly feeling really light, and you can just sort of push off the floor, and just float around for about 20 seconds and sort of hang out in the middle of the cabin or stand on the ceiling or zen out in midair.
Now, you've clocked up over like 4 hours of this, haven't you?
Yeah.
In 30-second bursts.
Yeah.
You've done it a lot.
It's a lot of fun.
It sounds incredible. We should do a talk show up there one day. Yeah. Desk floats away.
Yeah, now you're talking.
So you go from zero-G flight director... One of the greatest titles I've ever heard, by the way. That is so cool. Zero-G flight director. What was then... How did you get tied up in Virgin Galactic?
So in 2005, my fiancé, George, my now husband, George Whitesides, he said he bought us tickets to fly on Virgin Galactic on a suborbital flight. So we became Virgin Galactic future astronauts. In fact, we were founder astronauts. We were two of the first 100 people... To put down our money.
So how does a conversation between a couple end with like, so if like if instead of being like, well, we should go buy a house, were you guys like, let's go to space?
Pretty much, yeah. Luckily, we were on the same page with that.
You know,
a lot of couples, that conversation is not going to go very well.
I can imagine.
But we were like, yeah, that's
perfect.
Let's
do it.
Of course, that's what we should do.
So you buy the tickets, then you've been caught up and. Wow. Do you know the date or roughly when you're going to be able to go up there? Is it?
Virgin Galactic is always, you know, very responsible. And they say, you know, we'll go when we're ready.
Yeah, cool.
Because you're in a test flight program.
Yeah.
So you don't know what's going to happen.
Perfect.
But, you know.
You've got the tickets.
You're
in.
We're going.
You're absolutely doing it. So tell me, what right now, what are the messages that you're trying to put out there? What are the really important things to you?
Well, what I'm certainly really excited about is having, you know, our customers have the most profound experience possible. This is the experience of the overview effect of like feeling connected with everyone and everything and seeing the fragility of the earth and just coming back, you know, with a sort of life-changing experience and then being ready to go back into your community and your friends and family and share that with them and really change the world. I mean, I'm interested in having us build the culture of the sci-fi future, not just the spaceship. So we got to like...
And that's a very interesting premise that you've put there. There is always so much focus on the technology about how we're going to do this, not so much about almost the psyche of the people who are going to be the explorers and how they communicate with those back on Earth.
Yeah. No, it's really important. I mean, in any area of technology, you know, it's like how we use the technology is what really matters.
Yeah.
And if we're not using our technology to make the world a better place or make us better people, you know, for me, it's not as interesting.
Yeah. It is absolutely incredible. Have you got any speeches or have you got any things coming up that people can come and see you at?
Yeah, absolutely. I'm going to be speaking at the UCLA Ideas event Tuesday, May 12th, down here in Playa Vista. And I'll be again at TEDx Pasadena Women on Saturday, May 30th.
Awesome. Fantastic. Loretta, I just want to say thank you so much. It's been absolutely wonderful. Loretta Whitesides, ladies and gentlemen. Loretta. So he's considered one of the world's best minds in 3D printing. He's won an amazing amount of awards. You can see his work in museums across the world. He's also the creative director of the world's largest 3D printing company. He is Yanni Katayan. Give me some of that. Yanni, what a pleasure it is to have you up here on stage.
Oh, great to be here.
First of all, what's this? Tell me about this.
You know, some accessories.
3D printed?
Of course, yes. You want to have it?
I love it.
First gift tonight.
Don't.
Yes, it's all yours. All yours.
Oh!
I have more gifts later.
I really like your jacket and your shoes and your pants and your watch.
No. Watch is not to go. Shoes, yes. They were cheap.
This is incredible. Thank you. Tell me, can we do a tight shot on that? It's interlocked geometric patterns.
Yes.
How does such an object come about? Is that all just printed in one shot?
Yes, one go comes out of a printer.
Wow. How amazing is that? Please, using this as an example, explain to me, how is this metal? Is it plastic?
That's a metalized plastic. But of course, we can also make directly metals too, or you know, 150 different kinds of materials.
150?
More or less, yeah.
Chocolate?
Also chocolate, yes. You hungry?
One of these out of chocolate. Nom, 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 nom. So tell me about your background. Where did you start? Did you always want to get into this field, or were you an artist too as a kid?
Actually, I have a kind of a diverse background. So I have a sports background, which kind of gave me, I think, focus for the journey in my life. And I went to art school. Study 3D printing. We didn't have computers.
Yeah.
So I was the only student with a computer, and my peers told me that computer will kill your creativity.
Don't.
So I was a bit like, okay, and you're going to be so unemployed.
Do you want to say hello to them now? Give them a wave. What a classic. So you literally were told computers are going to kill your creativity.
Yes.
Dangerous, dangerous. So you obviously battled past that. How did you do that? How did you keep your interests and not sort of succumb?
Interest to what?
How did you keep your interests in the creativity space and not sort of succumb to what they were saying and go, no, I won't use the computer, I'll just stick to paper? And
well, you know, when you're a very angry teenager with a lot of bottled energy, then you kind of look, oh, I'll show you. It gives you even more energy.
So. You rebelled.
Of course.
Fight the system.
Didn't you?
A little bit. So much so.
Maybe they were smart enough. They were like, you know what, we'll give it to him on purpose. I still don't know.
Yeah.
I didn't ask them.
Right, so you get to the end of all of that. How did you then start to get involved in 3D printing? Where did that sort of point come about?
I wasn't interested in the technology per se. I was more looking at, you know, I was an art student and I was looking at the world of products. You know, looking at, you know, how people made, you know, the same things all over again. You know, maybe this year they're like a green couch and next year it's going to be blue. And at the end of the day, everything ends up, you know, in a stockpile. So I kind of lost interest in design very early on. I didn't see any point designing something for that kind of ecosystem. So it's more of an interest of looking at the world of how things were stored, how were they shipped, how they were manufactured. So I was more looking at designing an entire infrastructure instead of products. So I created this augmented reality environment where people will be able to upload products into their spaces and interact with them, but only produce what they needed and leave the rest in the virtual world.
This is absolutely incredible. When do you think that type of scenario, do you think that's going to become complete mainstream at some stage? Are we?
I think it's already happening. We have, you know, whether you have Google Glass, I don't know why it failed, but you know, funny thing, VR started many, many years ago, but it's only in the last couple of years we're getting a lot of traction for it. So I see all these different kinds of technologies coming together in a very interesting way, but it just takes a few decades to get there.
Yeah.
Same thing with 3D printing. Not many people know, but the technology has been there for over 30 years. And only now, the last couple of years, it's getting more and more interesting. And we're also now looking at how to really take those products and recycle them and make things locally. So it just takes some time.
And so with that, the consumer 3D printers that are coming about, they didn't exist when you started. How did you actually get printouts when you very first started? How were you 3D printing items?
Well, I was looking at these industrial companies who were making prototypes for, let's say, the aerospace industry or the car industry. But, you know, they were mainly making prototypes, and I had no money, so the only thing I had was my underwear, my couch, and my laptop that I got from my dad, and some illegal software. And the only thing I did, I decided sending these designs to these companies, like, could you make this for me? And they've never seen this kind of stuff before. They're like, whoa, this is incredible. Let's just make it.
And so was it like complex geometric patterns? What was it looking like?
Yeah, very organic things. I mean, I have, I spent all my childhood in the nature, you know, collecting butterflies and, you know, raising them. And my dad gave us a little cyanide. So.
Sorry, what? What?
Did I say that? Well, not like, it didn't. Give me, but I had access to it. Let's put it this way.
I'm still confused. Why?
Well, you know, by looking back, I think it was a little bit irresponsible, but you know, we had a very... I had a lot of freedom, let's put it this way. My dad wasn't there to watch me how far I climb up the tree.
Not with a bottle of cyanide. Okay, so...
So I don't know. Maybe you had influence. I don't know.
So we've got had you started a company at this stage that you were 3D printing items? Was that through
before or after cyanide?
Post cyanide.
Why started my company at the same time as I had my underwear under my couch? So pretty much when I was an art student. So you know I was then raving people like this new thing that was going to come up. Everybody would have these printers in their homes, and you would download the data, and then you would make, you know, it'll make this today, and the next day it'll recycle and make something else. And they all looked at me like I was a freak show. But in my underwear, I probably looked like a freak
show. Yeah, holding a bottle of cyanide. You were terrifying is what you were. So then...
Actually, speaking of which, I should go back and make stuff out of cyanide powder. Maybe you could make something interesting. I don't know.
Maybe. Do I still want this? Is that?
It's plated.
It's you got to really bite hard to get inside. So, you are now the creative director of the largest 3D printing company in the world.
I don't know why they picked me, but
ridiculous, because you're an amazing person. That's why. When that occurred, did you think to yourself, right, I've made it. This is it. Or what are your next goals? Where do you go from here?
Well, I kind of see their interaction with different kinds of technologies coming together, you know, whether it's 3D printing combined with VR to food to space exploration. Maybe there's magic happening there in between, but I'm more looking at if you're purely looking at it from a 3D printing perspective, I'm not looking at that as a manufacturing or prototyping technology, but more as a how can we use it as a transportation tool, a communication device, you know.
What's an example of that?
A communication device. So imagine we're able to, I don't know what part I believe in it, but I have gut feeling that there's something there. So imagine you're a medium and your grandmother is talking to her and then telling you that she said something. You know, maybe there's something there. Maybe we can have an ability to sense energy, or maybe somebody has. So if we're able to trace energy, we should be able to turn that into point clouds, and then feed the data into a 3D printer. So physically creating a communication device between another dimension that we just can't understand, because we only understand X, Y, Z, only three dimensions. So I could kind of like...
Yeah!
I could hypothetically print your grandmother's ghost.
My goodness! So we're talking like, if we found new streams of data in the form of other energies that we don't really know about and how to transform them into a physical item, that's incredible. Like, that is... Amazing.
It sounds very simple, to be honest, but it's just we're very, we're pretty stupid. I mean, we kind of, you know, look at the world like this, but there's so many dimensions out there that we just don't know. I mean, can we trace your feelings? How can we trace your energy? You know, all of a sudden you're running around in the beach and you think of a person and at the same time that person the same thought. I mean, we have no understanding how these things work. Can we trace it? Can we translate it? Create a new language? Maybe.
And this is what I love about you. It's not just about creating products and so on. Your vision is actually going completely into the possibilities, the realms that are out there. Where do you spend most of your time in terms of energy spent? Are you spending a lot of them thinking about forward events? Are you creating products? How do you spend your days?
Well, I'm creating new products as well. I mean, of course, you need commerce as well to support your cyanide story, so you need to to create work for commerce. But my main interest is in the future, looking concepts, you know, 5-10 years ahead.
What is a pivotal one that you think's realistically coming within, say, the next 5 years? Are we going to see a sort of saturation where 3D printers are in everyone's houses, or maybe at 7-Elevens? Where do you think we'll be in 5 years?
Well, I think that's happening already now. You know, you have printers really available for all the consumers, sub $1,000 or even less. So I can make you a pair of shoes for $20, and every day you can make a new pair and, you know, put it back in the machine and, you know, kind of close the loop of your personal production.
And do you see that happening within 5 years? Do you think, like, a percentage of, say, the audience will be wearing 3D printed clothing?
Let's start from accessories. So, like, you know, stuff like that. I mean, we've made clothing for a long time, but it's just a matter of the materials to develop. And now there's so much buzz around the technology that, you know, you never know what the next garage engineer will come up with. And that's fantastic.
Yeah. Your working environment at the moment is, and this is how we actually met for the first time, was inside Will.i.am Studios. Does Will have input into things that you're working on as well? Are we seeing a fusion of entertainment and technology, and do you think that that's going to propel more? What are your thoughts around that?
It's a fantastic space, and I love being there because it gives you an enormous amount of new energy from different kinds of technologies. You have mobile, VR, music, entertainment, dance, 3D, everything coming together. And as I said before, I mean, I really think that the magic is somewhere in the middle. Not just linearly looking at 3D printing as one technology. You need to feed it with all different kinds of aspects, and then I hope magic happens. So I've only lived there for 6 months, so let's see what happens.
Yeah, I think it's an intriguing mix. And as I said before, I think the worlds of engineers, scientists, they are the new rock stars, and you're almost living that definition at the moment.
I'm trying to learn to sing and dance at the moment, so it's kind of stiff.
If you can moonwalk, I'll give you $20.
20? 30.
Kind of haggle. So what are, like, you've got literally product in museums across the world. Is that something that you're going to continue to do as well, or where do you see yourself in 5-10 years? Well,
funny that you mentioned the museums, because the very first things that I made went to MoMA about 15 years ago, and they gave me this letter, you know, the sign and all kinds of stamps that your designs are in the permanent collection of the MoMA. And it's a bit like, yeah, but it's digital. So, how does that link together? So they looked at it still as a, hey, nice lamp, museum. And I was like, well, it's just digital data. I can reproduce it, mash it up, do whatever I want. So how?
Yeah.
How permanent is it?
How do you think? Is there examples of how that's being demonstrated really well? Because you can. You can morph that, blow it out, change the color. Are there any sort of, what do you look at for inspiration in terms of, like, do you still go out and look at museums constantly, or do you seek inspiration in nature?
Well, I used to spend a lot of my childhood in nature, but I'm not really that interested in the design aspect anymore. So it's more about how to make design dance, or how to make design sing, you know, or how can we make, you know, take musical data and turn that into something physical, or a dance movement, you know, if you would 3D scan my moonwalk and what kind of product would that make? So again, you know, combining all these senses, we can scan that later.
We're doing it. We're seriously doing it one day. So 3D printing, it's still, what do you think is going to be the, almost the point that makes it that consumers really understand it? I think there's a lack of education in 3D printing at the moment from a consumer point of view, where they haven't touched it much and they still don't conceptually understand what's going on. Do you think there's going to be a very defined turning point, or is this something that's going to naturally seed out and just over years someone's going to get it, they're going to tell their friends? And
well, I actually think it's funny that you say that. For me, it's a very natural movement. You know, I don't want to tell people, again, here's a printer, make this. More like, here's a printer, what would you do with it?
Yeah.
And just kick back, and you know, you don't wanna tell your child how to play. Just go play.
Well, speaking of kids, schools are now starting to get 3D printers inside. Do you think it's the next generation that'll actually?
For sure. I mean, I always say that if I would have had these toys when I was a kid, the kind of custom,
you would have made this out of cyanide, we custom, know that.
Custom guns I would have made for Batman and all these weird toys, you know, so.
Anarchy. It would have been dangerous is what it would have been. Yeah. I'm scared to know what it would have been like.
But I'm super stoked about the kits, you know, so I really want to, you know, give in a lot of printers to all the kits and, you know, kind of like just kick back and see what they're going to do with it. And that's when I really think the magic happens. You know, they grow up with iPads and computers and they'll exponentially take it to a totally different level. You can't even, you know, fathom what's going to come.
Absolutely. Almost like how sort of 10 years ago, that generation really started getting used to writing code, was exposed to HTML. We've now got the next level who are being exposed to, like, OBJs and actually going inside 3D programs. I agree. I think it's going to be incredible.
And I think, you know, one of the key factors there is, you know, people had a meeting yesterday and they asked me, like, you know, define luxury. And I said, well, luxury for me is being able to make whatever you want instead of, you know, going buy a fancy label. So for the kids, I mean, if they have the freedom to just express themselves however they want, do whatever they want, it's like the best position you can ever be at.
So on that, the luxury brands, do you think they're going to start really moving into this custom-made world?
I don't know. I really don't know.
Yeah. I think it's what you've said there, though, is a very interesting premise, that luxury may come about from being able to create it yourself, not being dictated what a luxury item is.
Exactly. So look at the kids. I mean, they're going to look at us really funny in the next, you know, 5-10 years to come. They're like, so you couldn't make what you wanted, but you had to kind of buy what was there?
Like, yeah.
How stupid is that?
Yeah. That's awesome. Yanni, it's been an absolute pleasure. Thank you so much for coming on the show. Yanni Katane. Thank you. We're going to play a little game with an audience member right now. Audience, are you ready? Yeah. Now, I never like putting people on the spot, but I'm going to have to tonight. So, my friend, you here, will you please come and join me on stage? Yes. Come up. Please have a seat here. Have a seat there. Fantastic. Thank you. Well, welcome. What's your name?
Two.
Two?
Two.
Correct. 50 points. Correct. All right, fantastic. How this segment's going to work, it's a little game show that we're going to play with you. Let's get stuck into it. with our first question of the evening, a technology question, ladies and gentlemen. All right, let's see what we've got here. Your first question is, yesterday, NASA's space probe named MESSENGER purposefully crashed into Mercury after running out of fuel, ending a 10-year journey. It was the first spacecraft to orbit Mercury, had travelled some 5 billion miles on a journey that included 15 trips around the sun. Your question is, that same year that MESSENGER launched from Earth, Snoop Dogg released this song. What's the next lyric? Now, ladies,
see, we kiss her. When the pimp's in the crib, ma, drop it like it's hot. Drop it like it's hot.
Correct, ladies and gentlemen. Oh, ho, ho, ho. Of course, the correct answer was drop it like it's hot. I also would have accepted park it like it's hot, pop it like it's hot, or just clicky clacky sounds. You get 700 points. Awesome. 700 points. Absolutely wonderful. Hooray! All right, your final question. Your final question is a science question too. You're doing well so far. I think you can do this. You're doing well. Science. All right, let's have a look inside here and get the old science question out. There we go. Nice question. Silicon is a chemical element. It's the 8th most abundant element in the universe and the 2nd most abundant in the Earth's crust after oxygen. It also has the atomic number 14. Your question is, remaining at number one for 14 weeks was the Macarena. How do you do the dance move? Yes! So, have a seat. Oh, you had at the beginning. I didn't think you knew it, and I thought I was going to have you know it.
Yeah, you
know it very well. Oh, that was wonderful. No, you get 1 billion points for that one too. You get 1 billion points. All right. So much paper up here. Okay. Well, now that you've got 1 billion points, tonight we have a very, very special prize ceremony for you. We have called upon the prize master himself. He is literally the male model from The Price is Right and was on stage handing over awards at the Emmy Awards last Sunday. Ladies and gentlemen, please give a big round of applause for Mr. Jimmy O'Halloran. Oh. Jimmy, all right, stand here.
You told me it was going to be black tie too. Why am I down in one tux?
You're absolutely right. I did tell you it was going to be black tie. So, oh, I didn't even realise.
No, he's got this fancy different colour tie.
I forgot about that joke, and then I went to put a bow tie on. You've already got one on.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Tonight's winner will be presented with the groupie stick, the best known stick of all the sticks.
There it is.
And the nominations for the winner of Win Stuff segment are 2 for his role as contestant in what was an exquisite portrayal with such depth and vivid character development. Reminded me of a performance of a young Daniel Day-Lewis. I remember Daniel once said to me, Jimmy.
Stick to your script, Jimmy. Stick to the script.
I want to hear the Daniel Day-Lewis story, but all right. The award for tonight goes to, if you could hold this, please. Ladies and gentlemen, it's 2.
Round of applause. So, there you go. Speech.
You know, I was looking at for a deal on Amazon for a selfie stick because I'm going to Montreal next month. And fortunately, I don't have to look anymore because now I have one.
ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Jimmy O'Halloran, and two, the award winner. Welcome back. Oh. Well, I hope you've had a thoroughly enjoyable night. I've had an absolute ball. To close out this evening, ladies and gentlemen, the musical stylings of Tudor Williams and his band.
You're gonna say no, 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 you won't. You gotta go, gotta go, gotta go. You gotta go while it's still home. And now you're lying in the sheets, heavy breathing, as your conscience starts to bleed. Oh, you relent. And the worst part's that you know you've been here before. I got scars enough to show. You should've known. You gotta go, gotta go, gotta go. You gotta go while there's still hope.
Ladies and gentlemen, Tudor Williams. Well, all that's left for me to do is thank my very special guest, Loretta Whiteside. Thank you so much for being here. Thank you, Danny Katine. I also want to thank all of the cast, crew, production team. My name's been Gray Bright. I'll see you in the future on another episode of The Tomorrow Show. Good night.